Speaking of which, for people who may not be familiar with Kanban, maybe you can give a little bit of intro or in-depth explanation about what Kanban is all about.
Sure. I would like to say what Kanban is not first, because a lot of people read something on the internet and it might not be the most reliable source, and they might not realize that Kanban is not what they think it is. So first of all, Kanban is not a process. It's not a framework. It's not a methodology. It's nothing of those things. Kanban is a work method. There is a difference between method and methodology. What I mean is that method is something that you use in combination with other things. So Kanban can be attached to any framework or any process that you already use. It's not very common that you can use Kanban with waterfall processes if you want to. You can use Kanban with Scrum if you want to. So it's not one or the other. You can attach Kanban to any process that you use. This is very important. A different way to say that is that Kanban is the flow strategy. So it's a strategy that helps you to optimize the flow of value through your value streams from ideation to customer. So that's what Kanban is. And then we can talk about all the different practices and principles. I'm happy to dig into that if you want to. But pretty much it's described in the Kanban guide. So if you Google Kanban guide, you'll find all the necessary details that will get you started on that. As far as I'm concerned, all you need to know is that Kanban says start with what you do now and then agree to pursue incremental improvements. Of course, through the practices that Kanban talks about, but this is the fundamental stuff. Don't just big bang change everything. Start with what you do now. And using the scientific approach, improve your delivery times and everything. That's to me the essential part.
So if I understand it correctly, right, the history of Kanban itself maybe started from the Toyota production system. So going from there, actually, the lean methodology becomes more popular and also agile methodology soon after that. Maybe a little bit of history here. How does Kanban become so popular? Like it started from a Toyota manufacturing system. But then it becomes popular where all the engineering team and all the maybe non-engineering team even use it.
That's a great question, because we need to make a differentiation between the factory shop floor Kanban and the knowledge work Kanban. It's a very important one. The other word, the fathers and still are the fathers of Kanban for shop floor manufacturing. And they use it for a pool-based replenishment of resources and materials. So it's typically a colored box that is filled with a certain number of parts. When the worker needs those parts, the worker takes that box, empties the content, and puts it backwards. When they put it backwards, the color of the box is different. And that's how people know it's empty and they need to refill it. This is the most popular application of Kanban in the shop floor. It's used in healthcare and basically everywhere. This is what allows just-in-time population of materials and resources. And then what happened with the Blue Book of David J. Anderson is that those ideas, and I think they experimented with Kanban for the first time at Corvus. It's a US company. I think it was bought by Microsoft later on. I'm not sure. Many people at Corvus were experimenting with Kanban, and then they described the findings in this book. And it was a translation of this idea of just-in-time development or just-in-time replenishment, just-in-time scheduling into the knowledge work context. It became so popular because nobody has any freaking idea what is going on in the company. It's ridiculous. I talk to clients every day, to potential clients, and they say, we only want to know what's going on, and then we will think about improving stuff. And I get it. If you have 100 or 1,000 people, it's just difficult to see what's going on. And that's why Kanban became so popular in the knowledge work domain, because it allows you to see, it creates unmatched transparency. That's what hooked me into Kanban as well, because I was a manager and I wanted to see what's going on with my teams. And that's probably 90% of the story, it's visualization and transparency.
So you mentioned about visualization, transparency, flow, and all that. Do you think there are some principles that actually Kanban advise you to have in the system?
Yeah, sure. First of all, a Kanban system can qualify to be a Kanban system if it has certain characteristics. Having a visual board with sticky notes on it is not enough. It's just a very basic form of a board, but it's not a Kanban system. Kanban system must be a pull system, and that is achieved through the application of work in progress limits. And a pull system means that you allow new content into the system as soon as content has exited the system. If we talk about user stories or features, if you have a limit of 10 features in progress, you can start up to 10 features, but you cannot start the 11th one. You cannot achieve what we achieved back then with more than 1,000, and that's a good thing. So once we finish one of these 10 features, we have 9 in progress, we have room for one more, then we pull the next one to in progress. And that's why we call it the pull system. A Kanban board is a Kanban board if it allows such behavior. If people can take work in an uncontrolled way and put it wherever they want, it's not a pull system and hence it's not a Kanban system. This is the most important thing. And there are also other things like, what are the service level expectation of this Kanban system? This is a little bit higher level, I should say. Most people are not there yet, but it's a very good practice. You take a look at the board. You somehow need to understand what is the expected delivery rates from this system or from this board. If you use Kanbanize or similar system, it's reflected on the cards themselves, how long they are expected to take. But if it's a physical board, you can just put a big note at the top and say 2 days. We expect that whenever a work item is started, it will take us up to 2 days. This is also very important. The last thing that is very common and people should take into account is that the policies on the board should be very easy to understand. People should not remember what to do with the tickets on the board. It should be explicitly written somewhere. You do this when that happens. You pull this type of work into this column when something happens and so on and so forth.
So you mentioned about expectation of time. So this is a related question to that, right? Because as we all know, the task given at 10 for all of us, it's not equally measured. Some might take longer and more complex. So in a Kanban system, is there any prescription on how to break down tasks? Is one work item in progress should be equivalent as the other work item in progress? Because as you can imagine, if one task takes a lot more time, that means we are having that chunk of work being there forever in terms of work in progress.
Yep. Excellent question, Henrik. It's a difficult topic for many people. First of all, there is not any prescription how you must do it. I mean, there are good practices. One of the good practices is definitely make them as small as possible. I'm not speaking about minutes of work, not even hours of work. I would say for a typical development team, a user story should take anywhere between 1 to 3, 4 days. That's what I would recommend. If it takes you more than a week, of course it happens. Sometimes it happens, but let that be 5 to 10% of the work items. Try to make them really as small as possible. And this is the advice we hear everywhere. I'm aware of that. And when you try to do it, it's a different story because slicing work is a difficult skill. So what we have done at Kanbanize is that we assign sizes to user stories or features, whichever terminology you use. We typically work on features. We don't slice them into user stories, but we really focus on them being as small as possible. We have this t-shirt size, S, L, M, XL, and so forth. We have assigned an expected duration to those sizes. And then the development team can accept an S feature anytime. They can accept an M feature anytime. But if a request comes to them, which is an L or an XL in terms of size or complexity, they will push back like hell. That's the expected behavior from that R&D team. If the R&D team says, okay, I'll do the L and the XL, no problem, that's not the right behavior. We expect them to push back and go to product management or product ownership and say, hey guys, can we not break this down? I mean, it's too big. It's too complex. We must find a way to break this down. And then through this exchange between product management and delivery and R&D, 90% of the time, we will find a way to break down a feature, which is L or XL, into something smaller. Most of the time, we will discover that it was what the client actually wanted. The rest was our own imagination. And that's okay. I mean, it's good to have your own imagination, but very often it's easy to slip. It's easy to decide to solve a small problem and then solve a dozen more problems with the same feature. It's what PMs do all the time. So you should build in your process some sort of a check or a prevention mechanism from too large features entering the system, what exactly I described before.